Welcome to today. I am Matt Kahn, and I wanted to come on and offer you this transmission of healing energy, this transmission of presence, this transmission of love. I greet you with joy, and I greet you as the light that I am, that you are. For in the space of connection, we are one, not two, or even many. And so I welcome you into this space where we can explore how to be happy, even as empaths. And when we explore happiness, there's two different versions of happiness. There is happiness, which is just your awareness becoming aware of how happiness expresses itself. And we realize that each individual form is like a kernel of popcorn. And at a certain point, each kernel pops, and it pops open into a vibration of awakened consciousness known as happiness. But what limits the happiness is when your awareness is constricted and only looking for how happiness defines your particular popcorn kernel, or comparing your experience to the other popcorn kernels popping around you. In the realm of individuality, in the domain of ego, every person is a character in their life's movie, takes turns having circumstances that elicit expressions of happiness. And when we're rooted in our egos, especially as empaths, we minimize the amount of happiness available to us, only defined by the good circumstances that enter into our personal sphere of reality. But as we awaken in consciousness, what intimidates the ego is that as the ego is awakening and dissolving into expanded consciousness, as the ego surrenders, it feels as if its grip on happiness is disappearing. And the ego feels like it's losing its grip on happiness, and the fear is, now I'll never be happy. The truth is, the ego was never happy with its grip on happiness, and it can only find greater happiness without gripping for control. The ego is so afraid that without control, it won't have its proper turn to be happy. But what the reborn ego, the embodied soul, knows is that on the level of character, we all as people take our turns having circumstances that register to us as happy or joyful or positive. And of course, when things register to us that is opposite of that, we go into self-care, we go into our spiritual practices, and we go into any which way that we can nurture ourselves through an experience to ease the edges of ego that reacts to life whenever it is not a circumstance of ecstasy or joy. But the truth is, beyond the domain of ego, you can experience happiness all the time. But here's the caveat, here's the trick. You can experience happiness all the time as long as it doesn't need to belong to you. In this moment right now, you can be aware of many things. Certain moments, it's proper to be aware of the conflicts of the world, the imbalances of our society. And there are equal opportunities to be aware of the joys of the planet. How many new flowers are blossoming right now? How many new children carrying the codes for future generations of awakened beings are being birthed right now? Right now, parents who never knew that they would have the joy of having a child are holding a newborn. And because their consciousness is one with ours, their moment of happiness can equally be happiness inside our body, because what happens to the character and what happens to the observer of those characters can be of the same experience. So when we are not so asleep in ego that we need a happiness that only belongs to us, we are able to be aware of happiness that is always present. It just seems to ebb and flow in how it shows up in the circumstances of each character. Spiritual awakening is not about denying the character that you are. It's just making sure you're not lost in the edges or identity of a character who only values what they believe belongs to them. Where is my happiness? Where is my love? Where is my soulmate? Meanwhile, soulmates flourish in this world. Love abides, happiness ever present. And the more time we take honoring and celebrating the happiness, love, and the soulmates around us, the more the signal we give to the universe that when it's our time, I'm going to be the most worthy receiver of what I'm honoring in the lives of others. So how to be happy, even as an empath, is that we learn through the path of humility, the path and journey of heart-centered consciousness, that yes, it is essential to be present with the victories in our own individual lives, no matter how tiny or big of a victory it is. No victory is small enough to not require celebration. And every day there is a success in your life begging to be acknowledged and celebrated, which usually can be overlooked when through the comparison of ego, we say, well, that victory is not to the expectation of my desire, so it's inconsequential. That's what the ego says. If it's not all that I want, it's nothing that I want. Now, that's a very limiting point of view, is it? And we don't need to correct the ego, because the ego in itself is a self-correcting mechanism based on how much consciousness is cultivated in ego, which is delivered through self-love. So it's okay that our egos feel like if it's not all that I want, it's nothing that I want. We don't need to change its point of view. We're just here to say, I know, honey. I know you're really intense on that, aren't you? You really need that thing. And until you do, you think begging and pleading and suffering is going to force the hands of fate. It didn't work with our families when we cried ourselves to sleep, hoping that if they can see us suffering so deeply, they'd spare us the agony of their emotional, verbal, and sometimes physical or sexual abuse. It didn't work then, and it won't work now. Your suffering does not bring happiness into your sphere of reality. But self-love will soothe the pain of feeling separate from happiness. A pain in which happiness only feels separate to you because you're looking to receive, capture, and control a happiness that you want to be yours. But nothing can ever be yours other than your experience of it. Sort of like you can see Halley's Comet streak across the sky. Halley's Comet doesn't belong to the observer. The observer is simply blessed with the experience of seeing Halley's Comet. And just because you may observe Halley's Comet doesn't mean you get to dictate and determine the path of its navigation. You were simply auspiciously present in a moment where a trail of light streaked across the sky in a moment that probably won't return for thousands of lifetimes. And you were there to see it. And you were there to derive whatever meaning you give to it and to allow it to be as much of a blessing or a curse as you choose to perceive it to be. But just like Halley's Comet could be your experience without giving you anything to control about the experience, happiness is your experience of happiness through which you will have no control over the navigating path in which happiness takes. And when your consciousness has been awakened to a certain point where the happiness in your life and the happiness in the lives of others is more equal than disproportionate, then there will never be a day where happiness is not present. You will just come into a very high level of intelligence where you realize on the level of character, where you are the name that you were given at birth. I am the name that I was given at birth, like Matt Kahn. And what happens to this character is always the highest possibility of each of our soul's journey, no matter what grade we are moving through in this angel academy known as Earth. And if we are simply going to look at happiness, joy, inspiration, love, and fulfillment as only what does or doesn't happen to the individual character, then that's a path of endless failure, doubt, fear, anger, confusion, sadness, and defeat. Because in order for the ego to let go and return back to the light of its true self, to be reborn as the soul you are actualizing into physical reality, a living expression of alchemy, turning the iron of unconsciousness into the gold of an embodied soul. The ego goes through an experience where one of the only ways it can let go of its grip of control is through confusion, sadness, loss, and defeat. And this is what we as space holders are loving ourselves through. Loving ourselves through the surrender process, where when we stop trying to control what we desire, we can start experiencing all that we desire without it needing to only occur in the life of the character perceiving it. And as a spiritual practice, the more you become aware of happiness around you, whether you are walking by a storefront and saying, I'm so happy that your store is open, has made it through the pandemic, and I see you have customers, and may you be blessed with abundance. Through the law of one, the blessing you just sent to that store owner is equally downloaded into your field. And you are simply grateful that the manifestations outside of you gave you a proper moment of inspiration to download grace into you for how you chose to bless the lives of others. Now, if you are solely caught up in thinking happiness belongs to you and it's only going to register when this character is happy, you might walk down the street wondering why you're not happy, wondering where your life purpose is, wondering where your soulmate is. And as you're having that inner conversation, you're walking past a storefront that could have been blessed, that could have equally blessed you through the quantum mirror with the exact vibration that you're waiting for outside circumstances to create. And we don't have to do that anymore. We've gone way too far in the spiritual journey, and the ascension is far too along in its process for us to turn back or believe there's any other way. You are free to experience happiness in any moment as long as you know it doesn't belong to you. That's why there's a moment when happiness enters and there's a moment when it leaves. That's on the personal level. But then you look at other people's lives and there's happiness ebbing and flowing. And there's always a moment of happiness to perceive. Now, we don't need to perceive happiness in the exclusion of atrocity. We're just learning to give our awareness to whatever the moment is calling for. And whatever you need to be aware of in the world that your light is helping to transform will pop up in your awareness constantly. So why not go through the day looking for the inspiration and joy around you as your way of saying to the universe, when it's my time to be happy, I'm going to receive it at a deeper level. And what prepares me to receive happiness and for it to be meaningful in my life and not be in the situation where when happiness enters my life, it's the minute I start being afraid that it's about to leave. How many of us do that? The minute something happy or joyful happens, the first thing we say as empaths is, uh-oh, when's it going to leave? Don't mess it up. Don't shake it loose. And we go into a place of actually fulfilling our desires, and it puts us more into a fear spiral. And I'm not here to suggest that the universe thinks, oh, they're afraid of it. We're not going to bring it to them. Let me make this point very clear. From a fifth dimensional standpoint, your behavior does not make things come faster and does not make things leave faster. That is third dimensional conceptual, you know. And when I say third dimensional conceptual, you know what? What I'm saying is when the earth was in a third dimensional alignment, those teachings helped to open up the mind of the collective consciousness to move in this direction. But now that we're moving through the dimension of time and expanding into 5D consciousness, let's wake up out of fear-based spiritual ideology, because back then it was an opening of a perspective teaching about manifestation. Now it's fear-based ideology. It has an expiration date. So let's be very clear. Nothing you do in your behavior makes joy or happiness come faster or leave sooner. Just take that in. If happiness comes to you personally, you being weird about it, which we all take our turn doing, doesn't make it leave faster. Being in perfect alignment with the universe doesn't make it come faster. It doesn't. These are just the things we tell ourselves, because if it comes and goes too quickly, we have nothing to control but self-blame. And if it doesn't come fast enough, we have nothing to control but self-blame. And when we know self-blame to be one of the lowest vibrations in the universe, we know that the lowest vibrations simply mean a perspective containing the least amount of truth or validity. So it's not wrong to self-blame, it's just not accurate. And the more time you spend looking through an inaccurate lens, the more time you spend aligning with choices that are inaccurate for the highest expansion of your soul's journey. So let's try this. Let's try to repeat after me together. Seems like as I look at the comments, everyone is resonating with what I'm saying, and I'm so grateful. Because I woke up this morning on March 1st, 9 days before my birthday. Oh my God. My body is turning 45 years old. Can you believe that? I'm so excited. So in honor of this, and not just in honor of my birthday, in honor of all birthdays, because every day is someone's birthday. And isn't that a beautiful thing? I often think about that. I sit on my couch sometimes or when I'm walking around, usually from my car to the grocery store, and I think about whose birthday it is today. And I think about how many five-year-olds are having the kind of incredible birthday I had when I was five. How many 12-year-olds are graduating from what was childhood into adolescence. I think about that. I think about how many people are celebrating a wedding anniversary. And sometimes how many people are celebrating a divorce that puts them in the best direction for both of them. But this is what I think about. And this is what I invite you to think about. Because our world is literally like a scavenger hunt. Now, if coming from the perspective of ego, we live as scavengers. But the hunt, the search, the treasure is in being interested in other people's lives and noticing that, yes, like popcorn kernels, we all pop one at a time. But we're all in this popping together. And the more you become aware of other people's joys and happinesses, the more you gift yourself with the perspective outside the domain of your ego, which is not to push your ego away, but every time you have a perspective outside of ego, you help your ego integrate back into the light by taking space from it. Because equal to the amount of time we love ourselves, we equally need to have space from ourselves. And there's nothing more meaningful than taking space from your ego, than being aware of perspectives beyond just you. Let's try to repeat after me, then I'll deepen this teaching. I accept that happiness, joy, and inspiration love and fulfillment and abundance are always present. Whether arising in my life or the lives of others. And when solely preoccupied with my ego, I only define those qualities by how I believe they directly affect me. As if this individual form is the only me I am. But what if I am is not just the me of this one body? What if the I am that I am is the consciousness of all bodies? And therefore, whether this individual form appears in happy circumstances or moments of transition, or no matter how anyone else's life ebbs and flows, I can be the observer of Halley's Comet as the metaphor of happiness. And without an ability to control or a need to control Halley's Comet, I'm just grateful for the experience of observing it. Whether in my field of awareness or in the lives of others. The more happy I become for other people's happiness, the more happiness I feel, no matter my circumstances. And while my conduct does not determine how quickly happiness comes, or how auspiciously it might seem to go, by being aware of happiness as the awareness of grace. As the virtue of abundance. I am free to perceive the happiness that's always here, which on the deepest level, and here's where it gets fun, is not rooted in any circumstance, birth or death. Happiness is the I am presence becoming aware of itself. And when the I am presence is aware of itself within this body of experience or another, the I am presence aware of itself always creates a perspective of happiness, no matter what comes or goes. And so this means that happiness is not circumstantial. Believing circumstances lead to happiness is a play of ego. A hallucination unfolding on its way to surrender. How the ego tries to survive, not knowing it's attempting to survive in an environment it's only meant to wake up from. And when my happiness is truly rooted in the I am presence, then we reverse the patterning of ego. It's not I am because of what's happening. It's all is happening because I am the one here witnessing it. And this means, I know this is a long repeat after me, this is a good one. And what this means is that happiness exists in the awareness of the observer. The observed is just a play. That I will perceive from one of many perspectives. Depending upon how deeply I'm rooted in the I am presence. Or needing things to belong to me. Just feel for a moment. And if you wouldn't mind, in the comments, write what you're feeling right now. What are you feeling right now as a result of what's being transmitted in that repeat after me? Let me see if I can scroll down and see what y'all are saying. Kathy says, incredible, Matt, just hours ago, this realization profoundly awakened within me even more. I love that. How are you feeling receiving this? Sandy says, awesome. Hello, Sandy. It's an honor to see you again. John says, LOL. I love when laughter arises from a transmission. Claudia, some hope. So let's take this even deeper. Feeling peaceful, says Karen. Thank God. A deeper opening, make you feel safe. I love this. Thank you. Well, I love you all. And this means so much to be able to transmit this to you. Oh. Sandy, I'm not sure how I'm feeling. That's good. Because oftentimes when the truth of happiness arises, we can't control it. And sometimes one of the most subtle ways we control things is through our understanding of it, how we define, what we compare it to, how we contrast it. And we're feeling what's called undifferentiated happiness, which means a happiness that doesn't belong to any particular individual. So we can feel better, but there's a sense of, I don't know what to do with this, because we've been trained to control what enters our sphere of perception. And so we're just taking the time to relax our nervous systems into what is known as undifferentiated happiness. It's the dimension I meet you in whenever we meet. The happiness I perceive. There's infinite evidence of happiness in my life. And at the same time, it doesn't matter whether it's in my life or someone else's life, because my life is solely occupied with the awareness of joy in other people's lives, becoming aware of atrocities that I can serve and heal on an energetic level, and being so thankful and grateful that my light has an opportunity to participate in the joy and the love and the redemption of this planet. Every time I hear a story of something atrocious, I'm equally grateful that I'm aware of it so I can help and make it better. Thank you, universe, for help giving me another chance to be helpful in the lives of those that are helpless or in need of support. And that brings about a happiness even when responding to atrocity. So as an empath, what we learn to master is undifferentiated happiness. A happiness that, yes, when it arises in the life of the character you embody, it will feel more personal, and to the ego it will feel more meaningful. But you will notice that oftentimes the happiness that comes into your personal life will also trigger a feeling of fear of, now that I have it, I have something to lose. As you wake up in consciousness, you're able to be happy individually and not fear the demise of it. It's just kind of like playing spiritual keno or bingo. Oh, it's my turn to win. Bingo. I'm the winner today. And me being the winner is foreshadowing and reflecting to the world that their time is coming as well. That's the true mirror teaching. It's not other people's traumas reflect your trauma. It's other people's joys are foreshadowing joys entering your personal life. But when we don't make happiness just about us, we can always be in a state of happiness, even when responding to atrocity on an energetic level, a socioeconomical level, a personal level, and a communal level. You can be happy the entire time and not turn a blind eye to the hardships of the world. You can serve every soul in the world and never wipe a smile off your face. Now, as empaths, we learn to master undifferentiated happiness, which means happiness is always present, whether it's in my life or others. But in the beginning stages of being an empath, when we're waking up to our empathic abilities, because we still carry traumas in our bodies, we start to identify with the traumas of all bodies. And that's the phenomenon of what causes you to feel like you're taking on other people's energies. Because your unresolved traumas are in training with the unresolved traumas of others. As we go into the healing journey of loving ourselves more, not less, and healing and integrating on a deep heart-centered level, we begin to clear space out of our body. And that gives us more space to embody the light of our soul, which helps our egos integrate. Now, you don't have to wait for that process to be over to start mastering undifferentiated happiness. You just start to realize, if I have the ability to feel other people's pain, I also have the ability to feel other people's happiness. And the more time I spend not 100% 24 hours a day dumpster diving in my own traumas and self-pity and unworthiness, but looking at the world around me and saying, where is the treasure I am being invited to discover, with the present moment being another clue in the map leading me to the treasure? Will I find it within myself? Will I find it in the circumstances of others? Or will I find the greatest treasure called the I Am Presence, which is a happiness that has nothing to do with any moment birth, death, or inevitability of change. And let's try this together as a repeat after me. This is going to be interesting. A shorter one, I assure you. If I have the ability to empath other people's pain, I also have the ability to empath other people's happiness. Perhaps I only take on other people's pain to become more aware of the pain I'm in. And while I'm here to be aware of my pain and help heal it, when done through the lens of my ego, I don't heal myself. I obsess about the self I wish to heal. And in taking a huge evolutionary leap forward right now, I allow all obsessions of ego, all the ways in which my ego obsesses, all tendencies of control, and confusing love with something that belongs to me. All be cleared out of my energy field once and for all. Return to the source of its origin. Transmute it completely. And heal to completion now. Can you feel the energy rising? This is so good. And from this moment forward, here's the best part. And from this moment forward, I become aware of the undifferentiated happiness, love, light, fulfillment, and abundance that is the I am presence I am now. And whether good things seem to happen to me or others, happiness is always present. And when happiness is actually a level of consciousness, simply reflecting how rooted I am in the I am presence, which includes the personal self, not excluding it, then circumstance will never determine my state of being. For where there is atrocity, my light will resolve it. And I can do it with an open heart and a smile on my face. For no matter how deeply another human being suffers, I thank them for the opportunity to remember more of my infinite power by being inspired to help them. Thank you, awakening world, for reminding me how powerful I am. I'm ready to serve you now. And grateful for you serving me. As the I Am Presence. We are that I am now. Feel that, and so it is. Feel that. The most miraculous thing is that when you become more aware of the happiness in other people's individual personal lives, you become more aware of happiness, which is a perspective, in your life. And it doesn't mean when you feel sad, you should, oh, let's change our perspective. You could do that. You could do what's called a reframe. Okay. At the same time, being aware of unhappiness is just showing us the parts of ourself that want to be a part of undifferentiated happiness. And those parts need self-love to get there. So it would, to reframe, which some people would call bypassing, is kind of like saying, when I drive my car and the gas light pops up, it really distracts me. So if I unplug the wire that never puts the gas light on, I don't have to be bothered. You also don't know when you're out of gas. So just because we wish we were happy versus sad doesn't mean the sadness isn't playing a fundamental role in your healing journey. It's just that when you're identified with your ego, you think you're working round the clock on your healing journey. And really what we're doing is we're obsessing about the self we wish were healed. So spiritual self-obsession is not the same thing as round-the-clock healing. Because round-the-clock healing knows we don't actually have to focus on our healing 24 hours a day. When it's time to focus on healing, a feeling will tell you. Until that happens, our focus goes forward. Our focus mainly goes in the direction our eyes face. What directions do your eyes always face? Forward. Therefore, where is the treasure going to be found? Something in view leading you forward. If an emotion arises, if an upset is triggered, then we go from forward to inward. But a lot of us, when we go through this spiritual self-obsession, which is an experience we all have to have called the spiritual ego, it's just that all of us spend a unique amount of time in spiritual ego, sometimes longer than others. And we go within, and we spend too much time going within. And now going within becomes the new illusion or distraction. And so go within when your body tells you so. Your emotions arise. It's like your newborn baby is crying for its parent. Okay, time to do that. But when that doesn't arise, our focus is forward. Forward. This is a movie you're watching. The screen in your mind is this big. This living movie is bigger than the biggest IMAX screen you've ever witnessed. The step we take today is that happiness will always orbit your personal life. It may not come frequently in your awareness, and maybe that's just helping you become aware of limiting beliefs about your worth. It will always return. But today's step is not relying on happiness to just be things that belong to you. Because in truth, nothing belongs to you. You will leave this planet with nothing but what belongs to you, which is your memory of experience. And you will watch back your life on your life's movie on Life Review, easy for me to say right now. And you will simply see the level of consciousness you experienced each moment from and how that influenced your awareness and the choices you made. And so as we learn to abide as the I Am Presence in 5D consciousness, we start to experience happiness that will enter your personal reality. But it seems to flourish in a more incredibly bountiful way when it doesn't have to just be about you. In any moment, all you are being given is an experience. And so we have to learn to crave the taste of experience instead of remain asleep in a dream or nightmare of control. And what allows us to make this shift is how profoundly we love ourselves. And from the ego's perspective, when we love ourselves, the ego can believe, if I've loved myself once or twice, I got it, Matt. That's not new content, right? The ego is always looking for new content. Tell me something I've never heard, or use words I've never heard, you know, in ways I've never heard before. And thankfully, with my transmission, I'm always bringing things from different perspectives. But the ego will think, oh, I did that self-love thing once. Or I have loving thoughts about myself. The ego thinks loving itself is thinking nice thoughts about itself. That's not self-love, because self-love is not the ego trying to do self-love right. Self-love is the ego being the receiver of the love it craves, it dreams of having, but is completely afraid of letting in. So self-love is more of your ego in a hospital bed being treated by loving, compassionate nurses and doctors, versus this Matt Kahn guy is saying, love myself, and I'm going to love myself like I'm putting together a table from IKEA. It's not mechanical. And in fact, when I wrote Whatever Arises, Love That, since the day it came out, I've been thinking about everything I wrote in that book. For me, was a classic. And for so many of you, it still is. And I love that. And I started thinking about what I would do to update the teachings, to refine the Whatever Arises, Love That teaching. And I even thought about, would I write another book, Whatever Arises, Love That Too? And instead this year, you know what I thought of? I thought, I want to do a retreat where instead of writing it as a sequel to the book, I want to teach it live. And I'm about to, at the end of this month, lead that retreat at Kripalu. I believe it's Kripalu. Yes, Kripalu. Got it right. In Massachusetts. It's going to be an in-person retreat, which we are now all coming out of pandemic times and returning back to in-person retreats, where as powerfully as this energy you can feel is, imagine how much more powerful it is in person. Coming back to retreats, reconnecting in person with our empathic soul family, to be around those of like mind and like heart who allow it to be safe for you to be yourself authentically. To come together in person and via live stream, because it is available via live stream as well. And for me to transmit for the first time the next level of Whatever Arises, Love That. I'm not going to go on stage and teach that book. I will teach its sequel. And just like this transmission is taking your experience of happiness and awareness of empathy to a whole different level, this retreat for me is my gift to humanity to say we've become aware of self-love. I began teaching self-love 18 years ago when it wasn't very popular to teach. There are even some spiritual paths that didn't want me to speak in front of their communities because they had such an aversion to self-love, which now those in all communities are very aware of the importance of, which I'm grateful. But as self-love becomes a very popular buzzword, I want for those of us that are really here to take this journey as deep as possible to go to the next horizon. Because what I don't want for you is for you to be on such a path of seeking love that it just traps you into a heart-centered, egoic nightmare of self. I want to free you of yourself. I want to liberate you into the love that you are. And I want to help you be fully established in the I Am presence. And if you are excited, if your heart resonates with coming together in person or via live stream and literally experiencing what it's like to step into the fifth dimension and not wait for the world to become aware of a new reality, then please join me at the end of this month. There's a link, I believe, attached to this video. And whether on live stream or in person, I invite you to be one of many who will say, I was there, when the next level of loving ourselves and the experience of love liberating us from ourselves and reuniting with ourselves occurred. Each retreat I offer is different, and this sequel to Whatever Arises, Love That, which the retreat is called How to Love Yourself, I will teach once. So please join me for this. Literally once in a lifetime opportunity. It is my joyful way of saying thank you for the honor of serving you, which I am grateful to continue doing. It's just time for everything to deepen and expand to newer platitudes of consciousness, clarity, and relief. So just tune in right now. And if you can write in the comments, what are you feeling right now as a result of our time together? And if you would like more of that experience, and if you would like to actually go through such a transformative healing experience that this becomes the way you live your life, please join me in person or via live stream for this upcoming retreat. Renu says, are you planning to come to Europe again sometimes? Yes, I am. We're just in the beginning stages of planning that in the near future. Diane says, thank you for sharing this with all of us. My pleasure. I love you so much. Ramona says, I feel lighter. Laughter arose. I love that, right? As empaths, we laugh till we cry. We cry till we laugh. Again, we don't have to live our lives identifying with other people's sorrows and dumpster diving in never-ending pain. Nor do we have to hide from pain with manufactured forms of optimism. There's a new way. Bridget said, Matt, I love the idea of facing forward. You always do the thing. Thank you. Chris, I feel freed from illusion. I love that. Claire says, feeling blessed. Oh, I love that. Wendy says, so grateful. What an honor it is to be here with all of you. I'm so grateful to be here with you. I'm so grateful we're in this together, and I'm so grateful that we are a part of what is helping to transform this planet. Let us come together as empathic soul family. Let us reunite in person, whether in person or via live stream, and let us explore the adventure of the How to Love Yourself in person or live stream retreat. Please join me for this life-changing experience. I assure you what I'm downloading from the universe that you are tasting right now is just the beginning. And just as a way of concluding this, Kara says, self-love, she's feeling. Jessica, this was perfect. Toshimi, thank you, Matt. You're welcome. Everyone, oh, I'm grateful for you too. Let's just integrate what we've received today with a simple little repeat after me. I am happy. Happy I am. 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 Feel it. You can actually feel it more in your body. You can feel your heart opening. And for those of you that can't open the link, you can go to mattkahn.org. Click on the events page and sign up through there, that link. Now I want to show you something really quick. I am happy, happy I am. You can feel your heart bursting open like a sun. Now let's shorten it, and I'll show you the shortcut to happiness. I am. And feel that. I am. I am. I am. I'm happy to be here with you. I'm happy to continue to assemble with all of us the largest empathic heart-centered global community. I am happy to reunite with you in person at this upcoming event. I am happy to be the one that you are. Thank you for creating me to say these words to you. It's an honor to serve you. Whether I see you in person or via live stream, I look forward to being together soon. From my heart to yours, I love you. Namaste.
Hand to hand, heart to heart, we're